Okay, so hello everybody again. Sorry about that. It's clearly a technical hitch. So what we're going to talk about today is I'm just going to finish this last part about cities, which we sort of touched on last time. And I'm going to introduce something about interconnectivity, which we've sort of mentioned when we talked a little bit about ecosystems. So we're sort of coming back onto track again. So there are a few pieces that I need to move around a little bit. So we have a meeting today, and we have a meeting next week on next Monday, and then we'll have a break for Christmas, and then we've got the final three sessions. So I'm going to make a start, and we were talking about urban development, I think, last time, and urban planning, and we talked about how cities themselves have climates, and I think anyone who lives either just outside a city or in the centre of a city will quite readily appreciate this. And I think from the point of view of studying this, I think it's really quite fascinating, because we often associate climate with, well, natural spaces. But of course, unnatural spaces, like, for example, this situation in a city centre, because of the construction, because of the way things are, there will be particular effects on wind flow, on airflow, absorption of heat, the way water interacts with the surface, so when it rains and so on and so forth. So these highly, let's say, highly modified, highly unnatural landscapes will have their own particular ways of interacting with the weather, but also causing their own weather as well. So that, I think, that's a key point, that they're not just, let's say, suffering the consequences, but they are also part of the creation of the effects of climate. Okay, so if we think about modified spaces, think about how and where many cities were founded and started. So this is, I think, we did mention this last time, because I remember the photo. This is Vancouver. Obviously, the natural environment around Vancouver, for anyone who has ever been there, you will instantly recognize that this is not the natural environment. This is which is actually boreal rainforest, very rich, very dense ecosystem. Here we have a rather dense ecosystem of skyscrapers, high-rise apartments along the Vancouver waterfront, and of course the presence of these types of buildings has many effects, not just on the fact that the land is no longer, the surface is no longer natural soil, it's no longer forest, but it's actually paved over. We have concrete, we have tarmac, but the high-rises themselves will introduce effects in the way the winds will flow through the area, And they also, of course, influence the way the energy is distributed. Now, remember, when we come back to climate change, and when we come back to thinking about climate change, it's about distribution of energy. It's the Earth system trying to equilibrate the energy, trying to disperse the energy in the system. And what happens with unnatural spaces like this is that these can amplify effects, heat effects, and also water effects and air current effects, which in the normal, let's say, in the normal situation, would be fairly well under control. But because the surface has been modified, because the surfaces which are absorbing and releasing energy have been modified, this has big effects on the. This will have big effects on the way the energy is being distributed in the system. So if we think about, I think we talked about, just thinking about microclimates within cities. So if you think about a situation like the Piazza del Popolo here in Rome, this is a very broad, very wide open space which gets very hot in the summer. Compare that to Las Ramblas in Barcelona, which has which is a leafy, it's a very busy place, but it has lots of trees. And so, let's say the direct effect of the sun is mitigated by the fact that there are trees lining this area. Okay, so generally, big cities are quite intensely occupied, and this means there's a lot of activity, there's a lot of concentration of activity in a relatively small area, and this has effects for supplying water, supplying energy, and also for removing waste. So when we're thinking about recycling, when we're thinking about throwing things away, making waste, we all have our own, let's say, experience of this in our own family, but in a city we need to be thinking about this multiplied by X number of people. And so this is part of the, let's say, the thing of urbanization, that one of the challenges that urban planners have is to develop urban areas in such a way that they are sustainable, or they are livable in terms of the in terms of their effects on the climate, but also in terms of just, let's say, daily life. The cities themselves can or do actually have their own particular climate, and the presence of a big city in an area can alter significantly the air currents around the city, and of course this will change according to where you are, at which point you are in the day. So typically mid-afternoon, early afternoon, you will have, as the city is warming up or has warmed up and is starting to release the energy back, there's a whole set of, let's say, a whole set of things which are happening, including the this release of energy, but which is also carrying with it in the turbulent atmosphere. It's carrying waste. It's carrying the waste of the traffic and such like, including the contaminants and the greenhouse gases. So cities are, as let's say, are as active on their environment as big big forests or whatever. They are ecosystems in their own right, and they have their own particular particular characteristics. So looking at this photograph here, you can see this is you can see that this is a good example of urban sprawl, in the sense that it just seems to be buildings, the same type of thing going on forever and ever out to the horizon. And one of the key aspects for cities to become resilient to climate change is the need to be much more, to be much more mindful about how they expand and about how resources within cities are distributed and used, and also how the cities are developed as they go into the future. So many cities around the world have historical roots. And you can imagine that particularly in places in Europe, in many places in Europe or in the Middle East, where you have cities which may have histories going back hundreds if not thousands of years, certain amounts of development in the historical context, the possibilities for development of relatively limited, but in maybe the modern suburbs, this is where things could be improved considerably. So we have this idea of the city is not just a static thing; it's like a growing organism. And the spatial form, this is an interesting one, because the spatial form of the city from the scale of the metropolitan region to a neighbourhood block. So you can see that here there's some sort of idea of blocks forming here. The ways these things are organised will determine or will have a major effect on greenhouse gas emissions. So if we think about one of the big challenges for cities, is if you live here but you have to go to work here, you will spend a lot of time and energy trying to get there, and so transport and moving things around, moving people and moving goods and resources around can be quite costly from the point of view of producing greenhouse emissions. So some studies which have been done have shown that if you reduce the urban sprawl, you can reduce the greenhouse gas emissions. Okay, and there's a paradox in here, because if we think about what does reducing urban sprawl actually mean, it means concentrating. So rather than having, if you look at this photo here, we have the idea of lots of buildings which are sort of small, medium height, maybe 4 or 5 floors, and then you've got these bigger ones. Okay. The idea here would be that you concentrate the use of the space, so that you reduce the use in terms of it spreading out. But what that does is it creates more larger buildings, and the larger buildings themselves have a much bigger effect on the local, let's say, the microclimate of the city, because of the because of their size, their shape, and their ability to take in energy and release energy, etc. So, but in general, a key point for cities is to be quite compact, which means verticalization, if you like. Okay, so you may have this type of situation where cities just literally go on and on and on, and they're what are classed as low density cities. The thing in this with this type of situation is that it's clear you can't get anywhere without a car or without some form of transport. And in fact, this type of urban development is typically associated with North America, where at least certain parts of North America, where, let's say, space to expand was not really a problem. So these areas obviously will have a disproportionate effect on greenhouse gases or greenhouse emissions, simply because the things are just so spread out you can't actually get anywhere on foot. You need a car to get around, and so this is a classic example of urban sprawl, which is just taken over the whole, let's say, outskirts of a city, and it hasn't necessarily developed in any particular organic way. In fact, it's most likely it's just more or less happened. One of the challenges here is to create areas which are able to reduce the emissions, greenhouse emissions, and also avoid the problems which come from the fact that this type of let's say approach to building cities does create problems in expanding onto land which is not really suitable for habitation, be that for human habitation or be that for industrial or commercial use, and quite often these are areas on floodplains of cities, floodplains of rivers, or in particular places which are vulnerable to excessive heating or landslides. So I'm just thinking about a number of different places, which a number of different cities which do suffer from these types of problems. I know that certainly in Italy there are a few places which have had problems with landslides and rainwater runoff because of the way the cities have developed. Okay, so one of the things that does happen is that as urban areas increase and expand, there's more coverage of the land with concrete or with tarmac, and this of course creates problems because water is no longer absorbed, but it is it runs off, and water running off roads can cause channeling, such that the water runs in particular ways, and this can lead to flooding in particular areas of towns. So this is a really, really big problem because, of course, it's not just water that's running off. It's actually water full of stuff, and it's the stuff which causes the trouble, in part because the stuff blocks the drains, and when you get blocked drains, you get more flooding, and so this is, in a way, one of the symbols of modernity, which is having good roads, is actually an amplifier for the effects of the normal effects of water. So we've got an example here. This seems to be coming more and more common. Excuse me. Because of course the other thing is that even within a city, not all surfaces are equal. So you have impermeable roads, and you have other places, other surfaces which are less impermeable. And where the water goes downhill but can't actually be absorbed, it will accelerate, and it will carve channels, and it will erode, it will change the landscape, and this is totally normal. It's what happens in mountains with wind and water weathering. Okay, so one of the ways that urban planners have sort of thought about how to manage this is the idea of actually retaining the water, keep storing the water in the area in some way, and then releasing it more slowly. And so there are a couple of examples of this. I thought these were quite curious, because there are a couple of examples from around the Mediterranean, and also from central India, in the sense that historically these were places which had very difficult, let's say, very difficult climates from the point of view of water resources. And so it was very important for the inhabitants to manage the water carefully. Now, I know we have some people from Spain here. Some of you may or may not recognize this. This is actually the aqueduct in Segovia in Spain, and for those of you who've not been to Segovia, it's a lovely city. It's well worth a visit, and it has a beautiful beautiful cathedral and a beautiful Alcazar castle on a promontory in the bend of a river. The countryside around it is quite is quite difficult in the sense that it's quite arid, but it's still things are, there is quite a lot of agriculture, and this is because historically people have managed the water resources. And so just like in some other parts of the world, there have been attempts to manage the water that came, which was large. It would all come in one go and then not happen for months. And in fact, Carmen Martinez just put a, I think it's Maria Carmen, has just put a comment on the chat, and the Romans and the Muslims were excellent engineers, hydrological engineers. They really understood water. The Romans in particular were extremely efficient at being able to exploit water resources. Another excellent example is in the south of France at Pont du Gard, where you have this huge aqueduct which takes water across a gorge, and these were really quite phenomenal pieces of hydrological engineering. We've got an example of terracing. So terracing is another way of allowing people to grow things on steep terrain, but it's also a way of controlling and channeling water to allow cultivation, allow agriculture in places which normally would be quite arid and wouldn't be hospitable for growing stuff. So the thing is, though, that what's happened with the development of, let's say, modernity, is that because this stuff, these approaches are quite, let's say, traditional, old-fashioned maybe, and certainly not certainly something, let's say, associated with the past, they've been gradually abandoned, and this sort of goes hand in hand with the depopulation of the countryside in favour of the of people moving to the urban environment. Fewer people in the countryside means that, or has meant that, many of these old terraces and aqueduct or water management systems have fallen into disrepair. And all this does is it just amplifies the effects of the extreme rainfall when it does occur. So this is an interesting thing, and again I'm sort of referring to Spain because this seems to be the place where a lot of recent research has been done. And the historically, I remember this phrase from a long, long time ago. So one of my interests is castles, and of course Spain is a place where there are lots of castles. And the quote from Henry IV of France is that in Spain, large armies starve, small armies will be beaten. This refers to the fact that the countryside is difficult because it's a high, arid, potentially arid plain, and so water has to be managed very, very carefully. And so this difficult geography has been managed historically by the construction of quite sophisticated irrigation systems. One of the examples which I came across while pulling together these materials is associated with the city of Alicante in the south of Spain, southeast, and the researchers pointed out that over the last two or three decades there have been increasing problems with the irregularity and the intensity of the rainfall in and around the city. Again, in part because of not so well controlled urban development, but also in terms of the general, let's say, situation of the climate changing, and that more rainfall, more water is falling, but in a much less controlled way. Okay, so it was proposed that the stormwater could be used as part of the management of the urban water system in the city itself, and so the city council has set about a development of a set of infrastructure, which involves collecting tanks and associated conduits. And the important thing here is that while the idea was to manage this excessive rainfall in terms of getting the water to flow away, at some point it was realized that the water could actually be stored and then used as a resource, so for example for gardens, for parks, etc. And in fact this is what the city has been actively doing. They've been creating reservoir tanks under particular areas of the city, such that the water can be, when these storms happen, they can accommodate a lot of the water that falls. Okay, so there's a comment here about the Alhambra. This is the Alhambra, and I've made a point that this is not Madrid. It's just I was looking for another example, and I came across this, which is quite well described in the urban development literature. The only thing is, it's not a particularly, let's say, fantastically interesting place so to look at. In terms of an example, it is actually a very good example, because it has the characteristics of a place which has been, let's say, recovered from a quite difficult situation, in the sense that the land itself is steep. It has bad compact topsoil, which means that the water doesn't penetrate. Because the topsoil is quite compact and there's quite a lot of concrete around, there's not a lot of vegetation. And so what happens when you have an area which is subject to occasional intense rainfall, if there's not a lot of vegetation, the topsoil will be removed, and so what you get is you get erosion, serious erosion, and so you get sort of like a cycle, a vicious cycle develops, in which it's difficult for the for plants to establish, and it becomes difficult for the it becomes difficult for the water to be absorbed, and so it's just, the whole thing is just the whole cycle is just accelerated. So in this case, they replaced the topsoil was replaced, and they worked also on the vegetation to to allow to have more, let's say, a more stable surface, but they also created an underground storage system consisting of tanks, large tanks, and in a way, in several cities in Italy, certainly I know of Catania, Perugia, and I think is it Viterbo? There are large underground systems which the Romans built, because the Romans understood the need for this, the need for being able to store water and to being able to deal with water, excessive water, when it all comes in one go. So it's quite curious in a way. There's a sort of a modern movement, but which is definitely looking back to the past in terms of how things are managed. Okay. So the example here in the end has actually been very, very, let's say, it's been very positive from the point of view of managing the water, but there's also been another effect as well, and this illustrates the, let's say, the interconnectivity of things, how by fixing the problem of the water runoff, the rain runoff, there is less pressure on the manager on the wastewater system, but in the surrounding area, because of the better vegetation, there's a reduction of the fact that or there's a reduction in the heating which occurs during the summer. So it reduces the urban heat island effect because of the vegetation, but also because the soil contains more water. So this is quite an interesting example. Okay, so I think there's a lot of words on this slide, but it's clear that as far as the urban response or the city response to climate change is concerned, there has to be a, let's say, an embedding of the ideas of urban planning and design within the strategies for cities changing at all different levels. So whether that's increased verticalization, or whether that is so things become more compact, or whether it's increased decentralization. So there are almost never any situations where urban environments are created, let's say, ex novo, in other words, from new, simply because cities are typically organic things which are growing, and in some cases they may be extremely important historical context. So thinking about the problems of heat, for example, this is actually one of the arcades in Bologna. Bologna, for those of you who have never been there, is a lovely city at the edge of the southern edge of the Pianura Padana, and it's characterized by red brick buildings. The architecture is typically red brick, and in the summer it gets tremendously hot. Because it's sort of like in a bowl, which sort of collects the heat. It's at the edge of the hills, but it's not in a place which is particularly ventilated. And so, with the extreme, let's say, with the the high temperatures and the burning sun, historically people in the city, they created these arcades which line the streets, and so you can walk all around the centre of the city almost without ever having to expose yourself to the to the sun, or indeed the rain, the other elements, of course. So this is, for example, this is an older an old type of approach to the problem of heating and, let's say, movement around the city. So this is a nice example on a small scale, but of course if you're talking about big modern cities, then the scale is quite different. The layout of the streets here and the layout of the buildings means that you have quite narrow alleyways, narrow roads. You can't build roads where you, or you can't, let's say, implement solutions necessarily, which you may put in place in other places. So another example, again from Italy, simply because it's the context which I know best. The idea of solar panels in a historical city centre is a bit of an anathema. It's a bit difficult because part of the charm of these places is that you have cobbled streets and the roofs of the houses are in made in a particular way, and so it all adds to the charm. You can't imagine sort of replacing those roofs with solar panels. So certainly there's plenty of space for innovative solutions which may help these older cities become more sustainable with time. Okay, and again, the other thing that urban planning we need to think about with urban planning is that timescales, cities last for a long, 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 long time. Okay, so urban heat islands. This is a rather extreme example of verticalization. I think this is it's either in Hong Kong or in China somewhere. Urban heat islands are a widely studied effect, and it's very simple. It's to do with the materials, and it's to do with trapping solar energy, and essentially, as you change the type of materials, you get different responses to what happens with solar energy absorption. And of course, if you think about it from an energetic point of view, this increased heat will cause people to use more energy to power air conditioners, which increases energy costs in general, but also pollution levels. The general heat is general heat levels increase, and this increases mortality, this increases illness, as there are more, let's say, there's more microbial type of contamination possible. And so all of this is, these are obviously factors which people need to take into account when designing cities, such that we don't get strong urban heat effects. So what causes these? What causes urban heat island effects? Well, low albedo means dark materials. Albedo is the ability of a material to reflect light. So typically dark things like dark grey roads, for example, tarmac is a good one. Paved and impermeable surfaces, so it's no longer it no longer has the effect of evaporating water, like for example where you have vegetation, that will cool things down. Thermal mass, simply having a large heat capacity, so it absorbs lots of energy and then it releases this energy. In relation to these first ones, we have of course lack of vegetation, increased use of air conditioning, blocking wind, so for example stopping wind from carrying away heat. And of course, the more people we have, the more use of resources, energy resources we have in a particular space, and so it can become quite. There are a number of, let's say, feedback loops in here which go towards creating this effect. So of course these heat islands will have major effect on people and in terms of health. It also has effect. They also have effect on weather and climate. As I said before, the cities will have their big cities will have their own climate, and managing this, trying to keep cool, will affect our greenhouse emissions as we try to use energy to cool to keep things cool. What sort of solutions have people come up with? Well, use of light coloured concrete and white roofs. Also the materials, for example, the materials that people use, there are reports that paint containing barium sulfate is extremely good at cutting out or cutting down the absorption of solar radiation. So that this is a good way of reducing the amount of energy which is absorbed, but of course of course this idea of white buildings, again thinking about Spain, I'm thinking about the south of Spain, or I'm thinking about the south of Italy as well in some places. The white buildings in Andalusia, where you have whole villages. And what is this? Well, it's a way of avoiding buildings heating up in extremely hot environments, such that at least you avoid heating the stone, which then radiates the heat. You can use vegetation. Planting trees is extremely efficient. Planting trees in parking lots, in parking places, and being more active in how you manage this is important. We need more vegetation, basically. So moving on from this is the idea of livable cities. So again, as I say, there's a lot of examples seem to come from Spain here. Barcelona is pioneering the idea of superblocks, which are areas of the city which are sort of kept, which are kept traffic free or with the minimum amount of traffic, and essentially the through traffic which would once pass through these areas has is routed around it's routed around them, so this actually allows more space within the area for cycling and walking, and also it seems to promote social cohesion. There are more local shops and people are more, let's say, there's more space for community, for people to meet as communities. So this is quite an idea, quite an interesting idea, because it's moving away from a traffic and car dominated cities to cities which are, or areas within cities which are more dedicated to the people who live there. One of the problems, of course, though, is that the traffic doesn't go away, it just gets moved. So one of the criticisms is that the traffic is moved into surrounding areas, and so it actually becomes someone else's problem. The ultimate thing is that we need better financing for better roads, such that the traffic is not in the centre in any case. Better financing also for public transport, so that people don't necessarily need to use cars in the city. Okay, so I think this is one of the pueblos blancos in Andalusia. So, what can people do? Well, we've mentioned using vegetation. There isn't a lot of vegetation here, but in this type of situation, what you have is you have lots of buildings which are very close together, and which are reflecting as much heat as possible. Also, there is the adaptation. People don't tend to move around a lot in the heat of the day. They will shift their time at times when they are active to early morning and later in the afternoon. So the point here is that you can have, by appropriate design, you can have significant effects of cooling. Actually, Kamal's just put a point about skyscrapers covered with glass or mirrors might contribute to the rise of heat. There is a curious example from London, which is that in the centre of London there has been a fashion for making fancy buildings, and one of the buildings which was finished a few years ago actually is covered in glass mirrors. But the problem is, I think these architects had completely forgotten their basic physics, because they made a concave surface. And so these glass mirrors actually focused the rays of the sun onto at the level of parked cars along the road. This is true, you can find it on the internet, and it was well documented, because essentially as the sun moved around, the beam of sunlight was focused along the cars, and it basically melted the plastic parts along the sides of the cars. So this is something which is really quite it's true, it's quite true. So this idea of reflective coatings is valid as long as it's not the as long as you're not focusing the sun's rays on other things. This is about those types of coatings which are able to absorb the heat and degrade the heat. In other words, it sort of becomes low level energy. Okay, so more trees, of course, and just in the end, creating more green spaces, because it's quite clear that the urban environment with urban vegetation has big advantages in terms of creating shade, cooling the buildings simply through transpiration, because as plants absorb water and then they release it, they transpire. This requires energy, and the energy is because of the latent heat of the water, and this energy is taken from the surroundings, which has a cooling effect. So the idea of plants is extremely extremely important. Also combine that with the idea of more pedestrian friendly built environments, allows both let's say some mitigation of the effects of climate change, and it's also a sort of an adaptive process. Another type of strategy, this is from I think it's a place called Yazd in Iran. And this place is famous for its wind towers. And what these are towers which they're like chimneys, which are above the houses. The houses, again, this is a very hot area, very arid area. The houses are built around courtyards, lots of shade, lots of vegetation within the courtyard. But they also have these chimneys which pull cool air up from under the ground, because under the city there are a number of streams which run, and these streams, because it's flowing water and because it's underground, the air is cool. And these chimneys are able to pull that cool air up from the under the ground, and this is air conditioning, but from over 1,000 years ago. So this is again, it's like the Romans. It's very much an old type of technology, but it works very well in this particular environment. Okay. So, I've got a lot of references there, so I'm just going to stop. Okay, now, I don't know whether anyone's got any questions here. This is maybe a little bit vague as a topic, but I think it's important from a certain point of view, because most of us do live in urban environments, and I think we just take these things for granted. We don't necessarily give them much thought, but there are many things that we could actually do to improve the urban environments in which we live, and some of these things are actually quite simple. Simple things such as reclaiming some spaces to plant some trees, or to put some vegetation. Okay, so if I don't know whether anyone has any comments, on this particular topic before I move on to talking about interconnectivity. Anybody got anything that they want to add here? Okay, it sounds like people are probably falling asleep, but that's okay. Okay, so just have a look. That's the one I want. That's the one I want. Okay, so what I'm going to move on to now in the last 45 minutes or so is I'm going to look at this idea of conservation and interconnectivity. Now, I don't know whether any of you have ever come across a book by Dr. Seuss, a book called The Lorax. If you know this book, you'll know that it, well, you'll know that it's quite a simple story of this well, this creature, the Lorax, whose job is to speak for the trees, because the trees have no voice. In other words, he's speaking for nature. The book itself historically comes from the 50s or the 60s, and so it's very early, let's say, environmental type thinking. But in the book, the Lorax, who is this guy here, says, "Unless someone like you cares a whole awful lot, nothing is going to get better. It's not." In other words, it's a call to waking up and to acting in order to do something to help the environment, the environmental situation. I can imagine that when Theodor van Gisel wrote this book, he could not imagine the urgency that we now face with climate change. So I think it's quite an apt type of it's quite an apt quote that we need to start taking a lot more care. Okay, so the point here is, or the thing that I wanted to talk about here is the idea of thinking in systems. Okay, so I'm going to introduce a topic which is called the tragedy of the commons. Okay, and some of you may have heard of this. It's actually quite well known, certainly in environmental circles, but it comes up again and again in other situations as well. So I'm just going to stop 2 seconds and make a couple of comments on. Okay, so I got two comments on the chat, from one from Christine and one from Irina. So Christine is saying, "I think local governments have to encourage the solutions that you mentioned before when they project and build or renovate new areas." Yeah, I mean, I think it's just this idea of being aware that sometimes during a renovation or during a recovery of a space, you could add, you could bring in some green type of activities, or you could encourage the use of the creation of shared spaces. And Irene is saying, "I suppose we can't reduce or substitute some materials due to their specific features." This is an interesting one. You're right, I think, because technically some materials have excellent properties which are very difficult to reproduce. So I'm just thinking about, we talked about plastics, for example. In terms of building, well, everything seems to get made with concrete, but a lot of the concrete these days is not actually very good. The Romans knew how to make concrete, and their stuff is still, a lot of their stuff is still standing. So I think one of the things there is that often the modern materials are there for convenience rather than necessarily for because they are inherently better. So in some cases it's easier to make something with concrete than it is to make it with more traditional materials. Certainly a lot cheaper and a lot quicker, and that's in the end that's where the economics of it lie. Okay, so coming back to this, the tragedy of the commons. As I say, I don't know whether people have actually come across this before, but it's something which, when you see it, it sort of makes perfect sense, and it's surprising that it took such a long time for it to be formally, let's say, formally described. The guy who did the description was an environmental scientist in the 1960s, a guy called Garrett Harding. This is a photograph of him as a young man, and he published in 1968 a paper entitled The Tragedy of the Commons: The Population Problem Has No Technical Solution, It Requires a Fundamental Extension in Morality. Okay, now we have to remember that back in the 60s people weren't so focused on or weren't so aware of the possibility of anthropogenic climate change. And people were much more focused on the idea of population growth and population growth exceeding the limits of the limits of the Earth. And in fact, there were a number of papers around about that time which looked at these particular problems, which were seen as problems of the near future. The other famous one is the famous Limits to Growth by Meadows, which we will look at very briefly in another session. So, coming back to the tragedy of the commons, this is very much to do with interconnectivity. So, what is it? Well, in a very simple situation, a very simple description, it describes a situation where you have shared environmental resources or shared resources that are overused and exploited, and eventually they are depleted such that no one is able to benefit any further from them. Okay. And he argued that to overcome this, the resource has to be managed in an overarching way. So it has to be managed for everybody. It's a classic example of the tension between self-interest and the common good, and I suppose in a way we are living this tension at the moment to various extents, but this situation occurs where any individual acting in their own self-interest will draw from the resource without paying attention to how much it costs everybody who is doing the same. And that includes themselves. And this is very much about short-term self-interest over long-term sustainability. And so, in a nutshell, this is the the climate change situation that we're in. We have a need for action, which is collective, but at the same time, individual self-interest for many people, that the actions needed would go against what they would feel is best for them. So most of the examples that we come across for this come from environmental sciences, and it's the typical examples are where there are there's an economic motivation underneath. So in other words, it's the economics which drives the behavior, which then cause the dynamic. And from a systems point of view, it's an interesting example because it illustrates how this type of dynamic can repeat itself in many, many different situations. But the underlying structure of the connections is always the same. And this is the power of the systems thinking, which is that if you identify the underlying structure, you can see the same pattern being repeated in different situations. So what's sort of driving this is that this tragedy of the commons is that people see things from their own perspective, and they don't look at the importance of the shared resource for everyone around them. So everyone is concentrating on what's in it for me, and there is an unwillingness to actually take heed of and invest in the maintenance of the resource for the collective good. So essentially what happens is the resource is consumed very, very quickly. And in some cases this can be so rapid and so disastrous that the resource disappears and that's it. There's no way that it can come back. Now, for those of you who are interested, there is a book which I think is well worth reading, but there again I like this sort of stuff. It's a book by a guy called Peter Senge from MIT, and it's really a management book, but he talks about systems thinking, he talks about systems dynamics, and in this book he describes how you can look at different situations to try and find the structure underneath the connections in the behaviours. Okay. And in fact, the tragedy of the commons is one of his archetypes, and it's surprisingly widespread. Although obviously, in some cases, whether it happens in an office in a company, is not quite as tragic as if it happens out in a large scale economy. And we'll see an example in a few minutes. The point is that wherever you have shared resources but no overarching or unclear rules about responsibility, you will almost certainly get this behavior coming up. So if you have an interest in this, I'd recommend Senge's book because it's very interesting. Okay, so Hardin came up with this idea using the example of sheep, which grazing on land, as a metaphor for overpopulation. Remember that Hardin was thinking about human populations actually, because that was one of the key sources of angst at the time. And he said that, or he made this conjecture that privately held grazing lands, so in other words, fenced lands, would be managed more carefully by landowners, because they would be interested in preserving the value of the land and the health of the flock. Whereas, in contrast, if the land is shared, the owners of the animals will simply put too many animals onto the land, causing it to deplete as a food resource very quickly. Okay, so that was the dynamic that he proposed. And what's driving this? Well, it's the short term interest of the individual shepherd, who is trying to maximize his return on his flock of sheep. Very much economics here. But if you think about it, by putting more sheep on the land, it just gets worse, because the ability of the land to support a number of sheep is only finite. And of course, if one shepherd is doing it, the others will as well, because they have to, because otherwise their resources will go to other people's sheep. So there's a dynamic which is sort of amplifying and accelerating. So the point here is that he's not saying necessarily that everything should be privatized, and I think that's very important to say, because he's not coming from a neoliberal point of view that everything should be paid for, because of course what happens in a place like Scotland is that a lot of the land is not in a lot of the land is in private hands, but it's actually used for not for farming or anything, but for grouse shooting, for example, which is maximises the use for the private landowner, but isn't of not much use to the community. So, what happens is that if the resource can be managed in some way, then it can actually be preserved in the long term. Now, one thing I don't think Hardin took into consideration was that joint, let's say communal management of resources, that was actually quite common in the Middle Ages, because it was quite common for whole villages to have areas where everybody took their sheep or everybody took their animals, and this was for a number of reasons. But what actually happened was these areas were managed by communal rules. So you couldn't just take as many sheep as you want. You couldn't just do what you liked. You had to follow the rules of the village. So in some respects, Hardin has sort of picked up a good example, but in reality, in the past, it hadn't quite been managed that way. Similarly, the woods and the forests were typically managed to some extent. Okay, so what sort of factors drive these behaviours? Several: economic need. So some people are forced by necessity to do this. Economic greed. Some people spot an opportunity to get rich very quickly. So that's the example of the Lorax and the Wanslers. There's a certain amount of ignorance, which might be amplified by distance. So this is us as consumers. Quite often our behavior in consuming drives economic activities on the other side of the world. You might think about for example, the use of palm oil in certain foodstuffs. Now, you might wonder why use palm oil? Well, it has particular properties, particular organomechanic properties, which when you taste it, when it's used in food, it imparts a certain set of, let's say, not flavors but textures, and so for certain types of food it becomes desirable to use this in order to make the food more palatable, or to make it appear richer or better in some way. It makes it more attractive. And this can, drive deforestation. It can do all sorts of things. Avocados. There is an obsession for avocados, which I don't really quite understand. But avocados, in some places, grow naturally, but consumer pressure from rich countries means that people start trying to grow avocados in places where they maybe shouldn't. They start replacing their normal crops with avocados because they get paid more, and so you have a whole set of economic incentives. Governance is another aspect of this dynamic. Typically, there is a lack of overall governance, so the people who are involved in this system are not necessarily held accountable. In some cases, the governance is difficult because the resources may not be in a single territory. They may actually be spread across different countries, and this is one of the examples that we're going to see. So there's no single legal responsibility for the situation. Okay, so the example that I wanted to bring to your attention, you may have heard of this. But once upon a time, and in fact it is a once upon a time story now, once upon a time, until relatively recently, there was an area off the east coast of Newfoundland in Canada, which is this part sort of sticking out into the Atlantic. It's really quite an inhospitable place. There's an area in the sea, in the ocean, in the Atlantic Ocean, called the Grand Banks. And the Grand Banks is an area of the sea which is relatively shallow, considering it is the Atlantic Ocean. And it has characteristics of, it's the meeting place of two currents. There is the Labrador Current, which is coming down from the north, and which goes down along the coast. And there's the Gulf Stream, which comes up from the Gulf of Mexico and passes here just before it starts to move across the Atlantic. Okay, where these two currents meet. The Labrador Current is a cold current, and the Gulf Stream is relatively warm. Where these two meet, they meet above this relatively shallow area of the sea, and this becomes incredibly fertile because we have nutrients. And we have warm water. Where these two currents meet, the sea becomes extremely rich in plankton. And because it's extremely rich in plankton, of course, fish arrive. And so it became extremely rich in fish, and in particular, it became extremely rich in cod. So this was an area which was absolutely famous for the amount of cod which it could produce. So cod was originally called the beef of the sea. So if you can imagine cattle, because there's just so much, so many codfish here, because of the fertility of the waters. So what happened? Well, everything was okay until about the 1960s, when technology suddenly, well, it didn't suddenly take off. It's just that technology, which previously had been too expensive or too new for fishermen, actually became more widely available. And so, in particular, radar location of sonar location of shoals, fish shoals. This allowed fishermen to catch much larger numbers of the cod, much larger than previously. And so, there was a very rapid depletion of the cod population. And the catch has reduced season upon season, increased until a peak, and then there was a total collapse, and the catch has reduced. And after the 1990s, there were no more cod. So what was happening here? Well, the individual fishermen had short-term economic gain, but in the long term, there were no more fish. So I'm going to have a look at the dynamics and how this works out using the system dynamics type of approach. So if you imagine that I'm a fisherman and my activity obviously is to fish, but I have an incentive, which is the more fish I catch, the more I can sell at the market, which means that I will gain more money. Of course, so I'm economically better off. And so this will sort of keep working, and I will always have an incentive to find better ways of catching more fish, because this goes towards my gain. Okay. But of course, my activity is drawing from this resource. And so the more fish I catch, the more I deplete the resource, okay? But the resources user is going towards my individual gain. But if we look from your side of the situation, you are also a fisherman. You have exactly the same activity and the same incentives as me. And so as you gain, you have also the incentive to catch fish, more fish in a better way, and you are also drawing from the same resource. So there's a problem here, of course. This works for you because you are gaining. So the more resource you gain, the more resource you take, the more you gain. Okay, but the two things overlap, and this is just two. But you can imagine that there is a whole number of people doing this. And so, what happens to the resource? Gradually, as the resources as I catch more fish, and as you catch more fish, the amount of resource depletes until there is no longer enough resource to go around. Now, the thing with cod, of course, is that cod are animals, or they are fish, and so they have a life cycle and they have a reproductive cycle, which means that they need a certain time to reach maturity. And I think in the case of cod it's about 3 years, and so by eventually essentially removing the adult cod from the population, just basically catching more and more adult cod, there were not enough cod being, let's say, being there were not enough cod to replace those which were being taken, and so eventually, what happens is, as there's less resource, I have to work harder to get the same amount of gain, if I can get that at all, and eventually this just becomes completely unviable and it collapses. And in fact, I think this graph is really rather it's rather tragic, because this is the amount of tons of cod landed between 1850 and 2000. Okay, so it sort of increases, it goes up from about 1850 up to 1960, 1950, goes up from 100,000 tons to 200,000 to 300,000 tons. And it's sort of, it's a steady increase, but it doesn't look like it's anything drastic. 1960s, everything goes haywire. Up to 800,000 tons per annum in the 1960s. By the time we get to 1970, we were at the peak, and then all of a sudden it starts to fall down again, and it falls down to a value which is close to the 1850 value. Okay, there just are no more. There are just not enough fish around for the resources which are being employed to catch the fish. There's a slight recovery, but in systems terms, this is what's called a dead cat bounce. Okay, there's an overcompensation, but then the collapse is complete. 1990, zero. And since then, very, very little. And in fact, what has been shown is that the Grand Banks fishery is no longer the same ecosystem, because by removing the cod, a major predator has been removed. And as we sort of talked about right at the beginning when we talked about ecosystems, you have keystone species, you have different species which are really important in the ecosystems. And the cod was one of those, and it's been removed, and so the ecosystem has completely changed. And it's no longer, there are no longer any cod to be had. So by doing this set of loops, what we have is we have some amplification, which is that I gain by doing more of my activity, you gain by doing more of yours, but there's a balance, because the balance is the resource. We are both drawing from the same resource, so we can only draw a certain amount from that resource, otherwise we risk completely destroying the system. Okay, and which means that there is a limit. Okay, and essentially this is the story. I can't remember whether it was Aesop or whether it was Perrault. It's the story of the goose that laid the golden egg, and this is the parable, or this is the story within it. Okay, so other examples are things like traffic congestion. The more roads we have, the more we drive. This is a paradox from urban transport planning. So just in general, one of the big problems now is that many of these resources are important shared resources, but not necessarily managed. So for example, if we think about the Brazilian rainforest, many people around the world, and particularly in developed countries, recognize it as an important let's say natural resource for the planet, but the Brazilian government doesn't see it that way. So this is where these types of let's say situations are quite difficult, because quite often, for example, in the case of the Grand Banks, although it's off the coast of Canada, it was actually in international waters, it's not in Canadian waters. So there was no jurisdiction, there was no management, there was no way of managing that particular area. And as far as the oceans are concerned, we ask, you know, who owns the oceans? Well, the oceans, no one owns the oceans. But we have, because no one owns them, they become a place where people dump plastic, they dump fertilizer, and so, you know, they become places which are everyone's but no one's. The atmosphere, who owns the sky? And this is obviously, as far as climate change is concerned, this is a key example, because of course we take the atmosphere for granted. We breathe it. We can't do anything but breathe it. We have to breathe it. Okay. But it's only now that we're actually in a situation where we are recognizing the damage that's being done, and we're actually forcing energy companies, car manufacturers, and ourselves to modify our behaviour such that we actually account for our the impact on the environment. Thinking about the forests, illegal deforestation, a drive for cheap timber to clear the land for monoculture. This is typical of things which are driven by consumer behaviour. And quite often, local government in many of these places is poor and easily corrupted. And you see this when local governments sign deals with multinationals, extractive multinationals. So the the mining companies and such like, in order to so that the profits will go to the shareholders and not to the people who are actually living with the resource. So there's an example of this happening in Serbia at the moment. The Serbian government wants to sell rights to a big mining company for lithium mining. Lithium mining is going to be the next big thing, because everyone needs lithium for rechargeable batteries. And so, yes, we may have our conscience in place because we have a rechargeable whatever, but the lithium has to come from somewhere, just as the cobalt has to come from somewhere. Okay. Okay, so how can we fix this? Ideally, you would have different levels of government, you would have cross border management, you would have regional rather than state-based government. But for example, here, this idea that states may view restrictions on resource extraction as a threat to sovereignty. And this is absolutely true. This is the Brazilian situation. Okay. Sometimes sharing stuff which cannot be shared, essentially, is not so easy. And even let's say quite advanced countries have pulled out of treaties. For example, Canada pulled out of Kyoto in 2011, the US pulled out of the Paris Agreement. It rejoined again after Trump, but as this economist at the Columbia says, international law has no real teeth, and so all treaties are essentially voluntary. And I think this is the depressing part of it, that everybody wants the, well, everybody, people want the resource or want the benefit, but they don't necessarily want to pay for the resource, and other people see the resource as a way of making money quickly rather than as a something which should be preserved. Okay. So there are a number of, it's an interesting debate, because the resources, the common resources, will become more depleted. But it's interesting from a political science point of view, because it's argued that this illustrates the clear limit of the nation state as a unit of global governance, because it's clear that if you have something which is which is planet wide, such as the atmosphere, it's clear that a single nation state can decide what it likes, but it doesn't really have much, not necessarily have much effect on what other people, what other countries do. And some people say that this situation, managing the commons, has no solution at all. Okay. So, although the thing, it's definitely a difficult situation, part of the solution could be in making people more aware that these shared resources do need proper management. It can't just be left to let's say the market. The zero-sum games are not the answer. So this idea of, well, I'll just buy a bigger boat with a better sonar, and this is the arms race dynamic, despite what neoliberals will tell you, because this there is another idea in here, which is that it's this idea of freedom. And what does freedom mean? Freedom to do what you like with your environment, but your environment is not just yours, it's also other people's. So one idea has been to put property rights on public spaces, so that if you use it, you're charged for it. But I think we have to think about this idea of governance of things which are in common and which cannot be left to the market to be exploited. So air which is unbreathable, water which we can't drink, fish which we can't catch because they're not there. It's clear that the market is not. We need a better form of governance. Okay, I'm going to stop there because it's 6:30. But the point of the summary of the tragedy of the commons is this idea of it's a behaviour which plays out, and it's a behaviour which really pitches the individual against the common good. So it's sort of two forces possibly pulling in different directions, but of course there are people who are quite happy to work for the common good, which is a better thing. Okay, I'm going to stop there for today. Okay. Right. Okay, I don't know whether Agnes is still there. If you want to.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. So let's call this one a a day, and thank you everybody, thank you for your patience. Okay, and we will see you again, I will hear you again next week. Okay, thank you very much. Right.
Thank you very much, okay. Gordon. Thank you very much.
Okay, bye.
All of you. Bye, have a nice evening.
Okay, thank you very much, bye.
Bye.